Good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to another podcast in the Shaping Sustainability series. It is, at the same time, the last podcast of our series, and here we have a great opportunity to look back on all of the conversations we've had so far, to see all of the great initiatives that we've presented, and to think to ourselves what could be the path forward, both for us as citizens that are passionate about our cities, both for government officials that would love to also change their cities and make them better. And this is why I am honored to have two great guests to close this conversation. First and foremost, I have the honor to present His Excellency, the ambassador of the Kingdom of the Netherlands for Romania and the Republic of Moldova, Mr. Rulof van Ace. Manon Jute, who is a strategist and who I will tell her story a bit more in detail later as we dive into our conversation for today about mindset and framework for solving big problems. Like I said, this is also a chance for celebration and reflection on all of the subjects we've had so far. And that is why we'd like to first thank the Embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands in Romania for this cooperation and for making this possible. It has been an exciting conversation every time we've had the podcast. And I would love to give the stage to His Excellency, Mr. Rulof van Ace, for a few words from his side and a bit about the intention and the vision behind this campaign.
Thank you, Alex. And good morning, Manon, and good morning, Alex. And an equally warm welcome to all our online friends. It's been quite a journey, don't you think? I've been invited here to say a few words in closing, but to me, it really doesn't feel like an ending, more like the opposite. Ooh. This is because along the way, our campaign for shaping sustainable cities has delved into a range of interesting subjects and identified a number of possibilities for cooperation between the Netherlands and Romania. It has revealed, in our view, plenty of opportunities to work together, developing projects for the benefit of both sides. That's why my impression is that we've only just begun. I would like to therefore address a big thank you to our partner Urbanize Hub, to our knowledgeable and motivating host Alec Glod, and to all the experts who accepted our invitation to present their ideas to us. Please allow me to quickly name them and their field of expertise. Alex, would you be so kind to show the slides? We had, for instance, Chris Bruntlett, who contributed on bike culture. Here is some more explanation. Victor Dijkshoorn on green cities. Nice. Ruxandra Ailene on urban mobility. Servaas van Berkem on citizens' involvement. Wim de Kinderen on innovative cities. Cornelia Dinka on smart cities. Gijsbert Huijink on renewable energy. And today our main guest is Manon Jutte, speaking on mindset and framework for solving big problems. This, by the way, Manon, is an ambitious topic. You can always rewatch the podcast with the presentation inputs on the Facebook page of both the Dutch Embassy and Urbanize Hub. Our campaign, 1 month after local elections in Romania, clearly took off at a dynamic point in time. On the one hand, we saw the launch of new administrators of major cities. I guess the start of key officials with hopefully smart, innovative ideas. On the other hand, we witnessed the re-election of important administrators at regional and city level, rather pointing in the direction of continuation, also for project implementation. Our first podcast on biculture, to mention just one example, not long after, sparked an online exchange on smart mobility in the city of Iași with key officials, including the city's mayor and the president of the Iași County Council, and with expert NGOs. I was frankly impressed with the expertise and drive of all the participants, the representatives of the city hall, county council, prefectura, school inspectorate, the local police, civil society, and biking NGOs from Iași. At the initiative of the embassy, this exchange will soon be followed up with a two-day Think Bike workshop for the benefit of this important city, with the involvement of the Dutch globally active company, Dutch Cycling Embassy, not to be confused with the embassy I work at here in Bucharest. I don't want to talk too long, but this is the kind of operational follow-up I was hoping for at the start of the Shaping Sustainable Cities campaign. The Dutch approach to smart and sustainable cities is about working together on integrated solutions. Introducing biking as a relevant mode of transport in the city of Jas, for instance, is about much more than building bike paths, providing incentives to the local population, possibly financial incentives, making people see the personal health, environmental, and other advantages of using a bicycle over the car, introducing the necessary legislation and teaching children how to ride a bike safely are all aspects which are at least as important as laying new asphalt. Urban areas throughout the world all face similar kinds of issues and challenges. This obviously offers plenty of opportunity to learn from each other. The Dutch government and Dutch specialized engineering companies and think tanks have important expertise to offer in the fields of spatial planning, urban development, water management, logistics, and infrastructure. Institutions from other countries can help us solve the societal challenges we face in the Netherlands, in other areas, for instance, coping with the effects of the rapidly aging Dutch population. But given the magnitude of the challenge before us, it is crucial to share knowledge and expertise liberally. After all, making the smart cities of the future is really a key interest of mankind, not merely the business model of a few involved enterprises. Let me stop here. I wish you, Manon and Alex, a good discussion today. I will stay tuned and I'm open to future other valuable initiatives such as the Shaping Sustainable Cities campaign. I thank you.
We thank you as well, a great deal. Thank you for joining us. And I'm very grateful to see that you've really insisted on this aspect, that the reason we've made this series is to ignite this collaboration of bringing all of those stakeholders together. And we're incredibly happy to see movements already happening quickly. So once again, for the people tuning in and that have followed us up until this point, the impact of the series doesn't end today. As you greatly said, this is the beginning. And we invite you to stay in contact with the Embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands here in Romania and to use their expertise, because this is what we are aiming to do, to create this collaboration and to solve big problems, which leads perfectly into today's subject with Manon. And please allow me to do a short introduction for her as well. She's a senior strategist, and early in her career, she realized how significant the impact of the climate challenges and the energy transition are on our society. In her own words, we are reshaping our world, and we need to think wisely about the choices we make and the values we prevail. Since then, Manon has worked together with national and international governments, citizens, knowledge centers, and private parties to tackle these challenges. Keywords are subjects like smart cities, energy systems of the future, pre-concurrential cooperation, and supporting business models and market models. So, Manon, I would love to first start off. This is a thing that I always enjoy to ask our guests in the beginning. What made you so passionate about strategy, and how did you become a strategist as a career?
Thank you. Thank you, first of all, Mr. Ambassador, to be able to be in this list of people. I'm honored if I see the previous guests. So thank you very much. But I won't dwell too much on that, so I'll go to the topic. I worked in a lot of companies, like Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Infrastructure, worked for infrastructure company from energy, with electricity and gas. And every time I've been faced with the same kind of civil problems, but simply all the time it's from a different perspective. But I found out it's all about the same. Is reshaping the future, putting our money on the right place, making the right choices, having our civil society rights in the center of what we design. And that made me very enthusiastic. And that made for me the reason why I wanted to work and elaborate more on strategic projects. Strategic projects really that make our future and change our future. So that's where it started. And since then, more or less in my DNA, it's in my blood, it's in my energy. And I don't do Yeah.
And can you give us an example of one big project that you've been involved in so far, the one that you feel more proud of and connected to?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. No problem. Give me a few minutes because it's simple, but I need to explain it in a certain manner because not everybody is known with the methods that we used. It started with our Director General from our Ministry of Infrastructure of the Netherlands. And we in Holland, water works, and you talk about bridges, dams and sluices, they're end of the life cycle and they need to be replaced. So they were being built about 100 years ago, and the reason for building them was for shaping our country, for economic value, transporting from the south to our harbor in Rotterdam. So it had the civil society challenge why we wanted to manage the water. So it has been very effective, but rebuilding them costs a lot of euros, millions of euros. So then we always say, think wisely before you build, think wisely before you design. So you could simply rebuild it one-on-one, do exactly the same. But our Director General thought, well, thank you very much for advice to rebuild it because it works. But isn't there another reason that I have to rethink before I start building? So he asked a few people to sit down with him and the ministry, just to think in a kind of free manner, what other perspectives do we have? So I used to work for that ministry, and I worked at that moment at the energy infrastructure, and I raised my finger and I said, I don't know, but I'm sure there is something from civil society value that is combined between the energy and the water. Normally, you can't simply sit down and work together because that's not allowed by EU law. And I'll elaborate a bit on that later, but it's good to mention that at the moment. So we sat down and with a little group of people from public, private, knowledge centers, architects, whoever was willing to sit down with us. And we found out that the waters become too warm. The fishes and the flora are dying because of that. But that's also the area where we need green energy. We don't have enough gas anymore. We don't want to buy it abroad from political reasons. So we thought we have to find a new source of green energy. And then we found out by taking 1 degree off that water, you can heat or cool 1 million houses. And that's And if you then can simply repeat that every water works, you have some kind of gold in your hands. So this is one of the projects I'm very proud about. Because then we gave this perspective to the ministry and they realized that they could in a very easily manner simply take the new civil society challenge in that reshaping, rebuilding the waterworks. So, And of course that was the idea. Then you come to technical specs, you come with business models, market models, does it fit with legal and policy manners? So there's always a big path to follow on. But I can tell you that we are so far now that we are moving to the first pilots.
Indeed. Yeah. And I think this project is a great example of how one problem can be interconnected with other problems. And most of the times that's something that some projects miss, but this project seems to have integrated that view. What do you think differentiates this project from others? Like, why did this one have such a great positive outcome and direction while others somehow miss out on this this detail?
Yeah, so the Director General could have given a contract, a tender, to engineering companies. And then for sure you should have an answer from those engineering companies with their own market model, their own business model, their own innovations, the patents. But if you simply let it go for a moment and just leave behind all your personal interests, but first think down about civil society, then new perspectives pop up. So if we would have followed that path that everybody knows, that would have been simply a market failure, according to my point of view. Just by looking at this different manner and different perspectives and cross-sectoral and just being able to leave your own interests behind and first understand what society needs, you get a total different perspective.
And so, you actually mentioned this subject of pre-concurrential EU law, which kind of sets the stage and makes this a lot easier. Can you tell us a bit about how something like that can be implemented?
Yeah, very good question, Alex, because according to the law, you can't EU law, you can't simply sit down together and share knowledge. Then you have an advantage for upcoming tenders and contracting. So that's not allowed. But the EU understood that if you don't share knowledge, then you'll be stuck to market failure, like I said a second ago. So there is an EU law, pre-concurrential law, that you can take a use of, but not many people know. Not many people understand how to put that in an effective manner and simply follow it up. It means that if you join, it's not of your own interest. You don't get paid. You spend your time and a little bit of money for your own hours. And everything that is a result, even just sitting down together in a meeting, then knowledge is available for everybody because you work for civil society. That sounds like, yeah, that's a bummer. Why would I do that? Why would I share my knowledge and give it to everybody? But it's exploring, it's building networks, it's making new knowledge. And the outcome is of everybody. So which means you don't have to wait for a tender. You can easily follow it up yourself by having been part of such a group. So that speeds up. It builds a common ground. It builds new understanding and perspectives. And if you're lucky, like in our case, because we're not always that lucky after such a process, if you're lucky that there is a new business model and there is a new market model, then together you can build what I call a new cake, a new business model cake. And everybody can dip in and you reshape it together. So there's a piece of that pie for everybody. So, and that's so important to have all the parties that could be involved somehow involved in this process from sooner or later. So that you make a solid thing that fits in for the civil society challenge, fits in the situation, but is also future proof and is also manageable and buildable. So it's by starting right, thinking it all through and just keeping it in your mind, this could be one of the outcomes.
And how does it function? Is it like can you do this under a house, like a corporation house? Do you do it like a platform? What type of, in what type of environment do people get together for something like this?
You tip a good topics there. So yes, we, with a few parties, the Ministry of Infrastructure did build a house. We call it the Baucampus, which means translated a building house. Based on this EU law, that's the fundament of this Baucampus, and anybody could join, just by knowledge or just by being an interested party, or maybe donating a little bit of money. So we had a Ministry of Transport, we had a ProRail, we have knowledge companies, we have the top four cities of the Netherlands. So there's a big bunch of parties who are interested. And anybody who wants can simply bring a challenge or a big civil society challenge question to that Baucampus. And anybody who wants to join can raise his finger, hey, I want to be part of it. It's basically that simple. Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. It takes some human resources. It takes a little bit of money, but further on, it doesn't cost that much.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you've mentioned...
Yeah, sorry. Can I add on the platform question to you? Because it is also a platform. So because anything that's a little or a major result from these processes is immediately published on that digital platform for anybody to find. So it's a little bit of community. Mm-hmm.
So it's quite a transparent process because the more it evolves, then it is... So from what I understand, it is mandatory under this law that everything that comes out is available, right?
Yeah.
Indeed.
So you have to be really strict in there because you don't want to have the lawyers from the EU knocking on your front door. So it's important. And then you lose, you know, then maybe that new golden perspective that you did find for the civil society simply can't move on because you made an juridical mistake. It would be really, really a bad situation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would, you already mentioned the subject, but I would insist on this a little bit because I can already think of some of our more, let's say, practical or, let's say, skeptic people watching that are thinking, so, okay, I go there, I put my knowledge on the table, and then it's available for everybody, right? So then everybody does what they want with my knowledge and ideas, and they might be thinking, what do they get out of it? And maybe you can give us an example of some of the benefits. Maybe you can refer to the Waterworks project, but just to... And insist again, what are the advantages of going with this type of a framework?
Well, the majority of these tendering companies who want to have a contract, they're always complaining, bit right, that their knowledge is too late in the process. the innovations can't be put on the table, that these contract tendings are always very narrow-minded. They want to cooperate together. They want to sit together on the designing table. Yeah, but for EU law, concurrential law, that's not allowed. In a pre-concurrential manner, it is. And maybe you have a nice idea, but you don't know if it fits in a civil society challenge and in the multi-sector kind of approach, because finally, it's always a multi-sector approach. Waterworks is the land infrastructure, is water infrastructure, is digitalization, is always sector coming together. You can maybe have a nice idea, but if you can't simply touch on that in this multi-sector approach, you never know if it works. So if you just leave it behind for a minute, share the knowledge, look for where the solutions are, maybe you can put in your knowledge in there, but it's in a little later stage. And then so at least you get new knowledge, you get insights, you get new networks, and there's so many advantages in there. So, and like I always say, there's a lot of these contracting companies who have been in my project, and I feel a bit like my project. They are enthusiasts, they want to build, they want to move on to it. And if it's not in the Netherlands, maybe in Belgium or Romania, wherever they want to go, the knowledge is there. So you can pick it up and put it in a tender, a response yourself. So it's always a benefit. And just for example, we did spend finding that solution of 1 degrees, 1 million houses. That took us a half year in time. And that sounds a lot, but it's not, because we came together maybe 5-6 full days. That was it. So it's of course it's some work, and it's and you have to find a kind of working methods and a few other things. But finally, if you put all your resources and bright minds together, it goes pretty fast, to be honest. It's on one advantage we talked about before. So if you are a contracting partner and if you're great innovation, but it doesn't fit perfectly with the law and regulations, you can't knock on the door from the ministry. For us, in this case, the combined water energy system, that's part of our Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate. I can't knock on the door as a contracting partner and ask the minister, can you please adjust the legislation a little bit because the outcome is so great for civil society? That's not allowed. But if you work pre-concurrential altogether for the civil society and the outcome is for everybody, there is no personal interest, you are allowed to knock on the door. You are allowed to sit down and have good conversations. You are allowed to find solutions and to build pilots, maybe if it doesn't fit perfect with regulations yet, but then that's part of the pilot. So it gives a lot of chances that wouldn't be there if you wouldn't work in a pre-concurrential manner.
Indeed. And I like this example that you gave with the waterworks, because indeed it's a complex infrastructural problem and that you realize there's so many interdependencies. Can you give us another example of another project that is similar in the sense that it seems that there is only one problem, but in fact, there are many interwoven factors in the middle?
Yeah. Clefrasine, thank you. So this is just a few years active. Huh? So it always needs a kind of learning curve in a startup. So, but it is spreading around slowly. And we sat down with the City Council of Amsterdam. They are having a more or less a likewise problem. Their sewage system is obsolete. It's end of their life cycle. So I know Bucharest, you have a beautiful old city center that you want to preserve, and we have exactly the same problem in Amsterdam. So if you open up all these streets and roads and maybe houses, we know that from our underground tram system, it's a disaster. So you have to think wisely if you're going to do that. So if you're going to do that, are you doing that with a system that's already known for 100 years? Do you put exactly the same in there? It has some similarities with the project I just explained from water and energy. Or do you think wisely, what are the challenges now? Well, the city has also green and energy problems and challenges. There are some problems with clean water. There are problems with waste, etc. So if you look at the strategic problem list and priority list of the city of Amsterdam, you can see that the walls of our canals that are really old, they are collapsing. But behind that, there's space. So if you just simply look down at your, I call it a chance, something needs to be done with the sewage system. So if you see, we sat down with that as a starting point with a group of experts from all over the place, but also from Amsterdam, just exploring what we could do. So we understood that there is waste and sewage system gives warmth. Warmth is energy. It needs storage. Storage maybe behind the walls of the old canals that need to be replaced. So we explored that also in about a half year. We came up with a few ideas and presented that very proudly to a few people from the civil government of Amsterdam. And they realized that going the old way, just giving a tender to any contracting, they wouldn't touch on so many projects. It wouldn't touch so many challenges. So they thought, we have no idea where this is going, but you have to move forward on this path because that's the only way to let creativity, innovation, and the future of the sustainable city, that's what we're talking about. So they are proceeding. I think they are talking about the district Buikslot Ham at the moment, together with our University of Amsterdam, who is, I handed over my role to the ministry, to the University of Amsterdam. So it's good that more people adapt these kind of working processes, the attitudes, the cooperation, understanding pre-conventional law. So it's good that it spreads. So, and they're moving forward pretty fast.
Mm-hmm. Now, this story kind of reminds me of something very similar that I've experienced. But until then, I would love to give a reminder to everybody watching that you can ask questions in the comments, either on YouTube or Facebook, wherever you are watching us. So please take advantage of this opportunity to ask questions, because here's one question that comes to mind. You are speaking of a city that has a beautiful old city center and that has problems with the sewage system and, well, I live in one. Bucharest has that situation as well. We have had issues not just with sewage, but also the heating system. If you were to give your advice to the local administration that now is set on changing and modernizing and you know facing a similar problem, what advice would you give them?
So, good question. And I just have to ask something first. If sure. I understand well, you don't have an infrastructure is obsolete now, but your problem is also that you don't have infrastructure, isn't it?
Well, there is most of the city is connected, but there are new neighborhoods that are being built that now have to be added to the infrastructure. So that's why it's also the pressure, because it wasn't made for these many consumers. And in some cases, yes, we have cases of pipes just blowing. And then, you know, everybody is left without water for days. And the heating system is, again, something that has become a bit famous in the meaning here of saying, okay, once again, the hot water is here, but it's still cold. It's that's kind of the situation around here.
I understand. So that is an advantage because we found out with the water energy system, it is talking about warmth and with fish-friendly turbine, green electricity. Sometimes it's easier to adapt these new systems in a new to build area than renovating older. So we also are segmenting where you can start first and build on in a later stage. So you have some advantages. If you're building new districts, you can sit down and redesign the whole infrastructure from a future-proof mindset that I talked about before. I would really sit down if I were the mayor of that district, because if I understand well, Bucharest has different mayors and in sub-districts. Please sit down and think wisely about what you think is your living and sustainable future city. What is your perspective? What is your vision? How does it have to work out? What are your priorities? What is for you the most important? Is that digitalization? Is that company rights? Is that civil rights? Or all together? And from that kind of values, you start to think back. Please, maybe people sit down and think with us. I don't know if I'm going to finally implement what you're suggesting, but let's take at least the time to think wisely before we act. I would do exactly the same as our Director General from the infrastructure, from Ministry of Infrastructure in the Netherlands have done. Think wisely, because before you build, before you contract, That's the time to think wisely, because if it's in the process, it's very difficult to change them. Perfect timing.
Indeed, indeed. I think we also have examples of moments when, you know, certain projects start in certain neighborhoods, but then they only finish one problem and then they have to come back because they realized, oh, wait, we could have indeed fixed the other systems or made other interventions, but we just took it one by one. And then every time you have to block the streets, and it is indeed something, a practice that we need to leave behind, because there is an urgency. I think there's something that we all believe that, you know, there's an urgency. We need to act now. Everybody wants problems to be solved now. But at the same time, it's also wise to sit back and see it as at a much grander scale, because there are a lot of details that can be missed out if you just follow it from a simple, narrow point of view.
Yeah, and smart city, yeah, we talk about smart, sustainable cities, but smart city is also thinking smart. It's not only digitalization, mm-hmm. buying a new IoT kind of gadget or having some algorithms. It's about where you want to go. And of course, it has an IT component in there. And of course you want some algorithms, and of course you want some steering mechanisms and data you want to work with. But think smart means a smart city, and doing it once in the right manner. And then sometimes it's clever to think about something small that's future proof, and you can simply build on with building blocks, so you don't have to do it all over again, because the one neighborhood isn't the other neighborhood. So if you have one standard building block, but you can add other standards on, then you still have something which is tailor-made, but it exists from standards. So it's maintainable, it's serviceable, it's repeatable. So those are the challenges we're all facing with. It doesn't matter if you live in Romania or you live here, we all have the same problem. So no situation is the same, but you want to standardize somehow to minimize spending, to minimize maintaining and standardizing all that stuff. So think wisely, and it's in the beginning it feels like it takes more time, but on the longer run you hugely win.
Indeed, can you give us an example of, like, how many stages does a process like this happen? So, you know, if you were for someone who is in charge of a project like this, what should they expect in terms of phases in which they will have to go to in order to implement and solve this big problem?
Yeah, so now we had phase one is receiving that civil society challenge and sitting down together and trying to find a solution perspective. Yeah, this 1 degree of water gives 1 million houses heating and cooling. And if that resonates in that civil society kind of problem holders, then you could simply move on. Then we had phase two, that's finding the technical specs, making the technical designs, and on a rough level, doesn't have to be perfect. You have to have the feeling if it works. Then we design the business model with it, the business model from the water perspective, the energy perspective, the citizens' perspective. So you have to look at all of them. And then we said, in our case, don't look at this business model if you start comparing with the present situation, because it's not the same. But another green energy situation and equipment and technical specs, how does that compare? Then ours was more solid, more reliable in energy, and it did cost less money. Okay, then you have something in your hands. Then we went to phase three. We checked with market modeling and with laws and regulations. So we have electricity and gas that's monopolized, so that's monopolization, that's government controlled. But anything with heat is free sector. But gas is going to be obsolete in the Netherlands. So if you introduce heat on such a huge number of installations, then you could rethink if this is going to be the new monopolized, a new infrastructure. So you have to give our Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate a chance to think about, before all these infrastructures are really built, and then it's private sector, and then they have to rebuild it illegally to a monopolized situation again, because it's a necessary good for anybody who lives in the Netherlands. And that's the reason why we monopolized it. So that was phase three. So these discussions are being done at the moment. And meanwhile, we are in phase four. We are preparing pilots. We decided to start with smaller pilots for a technical part, a few other things to make sure it really works like we designed. And phase five is full-fledged pilots. And if that works, it's going to be the new standard of our Ministry of Transport, and it's going to be scaled up everywhere. So you can see these kind of six phases in any project, more or less. It's the innovation funnel. Yeah.
Exactly. And like, is the advantage is that if you have another city or another place that has a similar problem, they could use this as their own framework to work. They don't have to start the process necessarily from scratch, but it would be wise to also do their part in terms of pre-credential process. But I think this is the great advantage, is that once you solve one big problem of one city, this opens the floodgates for other cities to take on the similar initiative, and not just cities, but also private entities that could find this as an inspiration for whatever solution they would implement in their communities.
Yeah, you touch exactly what Amsterdam does. They have in their strategic plan certain areas that they can use for piloting areas for certain new innovation and developments. And if that works, they know that that same problem will be in other neighboring districts, so they can simply scale it up to the other districts. So they, it's not even between cities, but also between districts and cities. So that's part of the strategic innovation plan of Amsterdam. Well seen. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, there is one question from in the comments of saying, well, this interesting subject of pre-concurrential law, but what does it... So, for example, let's say there's someone in the local administration that wants to go ahead with this. How do they start exactly? Like, do they have to contact the EU? What's the fine print in terms of how do you start this type of pre-concurrential law framework?
Yeah. So first of all, look at the challenge you have. Is that really a civil society challenge? Because this EU law only fits to civil society challenges, so not for things that can be solved by the markets. Okay. If that's it, you can adapt. Just make a kind of fundament, legal fundament of the group that you're going to build, and you simply point at that law. We are going to work under that law, dot. So it means that we will follow the following restrictions. Nobody get paid. The knowledge is of nobody. We publish it immediately. It's civil society challenges. Nobody is the contractor. Nobody is the contract giver. We're all in there. We call the Ministry of Transport our knowledge holder. And then everybody who's in there is also knowledge holder, but then to solve the perspective. So we work in a cooperative manner, and nobody is the leader, nobody is the owner, and everybody decides on where this group goes. So there's not even a project leader. So we're all equal. So, and if I always say to the Ministry of Transport, I say, so if I come up with a purple bike and you don't like the purple bike, well, I'm sorry, this is what our group came up with. You're going to happily accept my purple bike. Hey, but if somebody's got a bike on it, that's something else. If it doesn't fit with where the Netherlands has to go, well, we at least know that there is a purple bike, but it doesn't fit where it has to go. Mm-hmm. But maybe the purple bike fits in Belgium or in Luxembourg or in France. Pick it up and go bike there. So it's you have to take the freedom. So if then a knowledge holder or a civil society challenge holder says, but hey, that's not how we work, then I say, I don't care. Because if I work now like you work, then for sure we're going to have exactly the same outcome again. And that's not my goal. That's not the reason why we are sitting together. So you give us all the freedom. We can forget everything. We're going to sit down. We're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to have a lot of energy working together, drink food. I don't know what's all going to happen. But finally, we're going to take the freedom to leave everything behind and start all over again. And if that leads to something very interesting, we're going to present it to you. And if it's so interesting and it doesn't fit with the laws and regulations, but it's very much a benefit of the civil society, then we're going to have a talk with the government. It's their decision then to decide if they want it or not. And then I always say to the experts, don't stop, don't kill this darling yet. It's not for you to kill this darling. It's up to the minister, director generals, I don't know who. It's their decision to kill it, not the expert who has to advise the ministry. So you have to keep that very clear. So if you keep that clear and follow this path and think every time, hey, what am I doing? Do I still fit to these laws and regulations? You can't go wrong.
For me, if I think of the situation, not only here in Bucharest, but many cities, and thinking about the fact that there's so many big challenges ahead for all of us in terms of reshaping our cities, because, you know, to make a city a sustainable city, it does require a ground up perspective and refreshing and re-seeing all of the systems that create it. And I'm thinking of all the projects that we've talked about, you know, in the podcast so far, about having a biking culture, redesigning green spaces, the way we integrate smart technology and how we develop that ecosystem so that smart ideas are being developed, mobility. All of these are so interwoven. It's so hard to separate them and say, you know, this is just one person's problem. And I think this is where there is a great value in this initiative and, you know, the availability from the Embassy of the Netherlands to facilitate this type of connection. So if this is a question that comes in my mind, if someone would love to collaborate, usually what is the recommendation? Go directly to the embassy and then how does it work from here?
Yeah, go directly to our embassy. They know us. It's a bit difficult to have requests and knowledge requests from all over the place. It doesn't work. So let it please be directed by our embassy. Their network is great, and their heart is into this. Just like our ambassador opened up this podcast. This is really his belief. So I'm sure that if there are questions, he will take it seriously and find a way to combine people and explore a little bit if this is somehow manageable and arrangeable over in Romania. Yeah, I'm sure.
Indeed. So my invitation, I think the invitation also from the embassy, is the idea is that don't be ashamed to ask for help. There are great ideas and experts that are willing to be part of it. And we already have this great example of the movement happening regarding to biking in Iași. And I'm pretty sure that this is something that we can adapt to many, many more cities, because just to give you some context, and also especially for our Romanian audience, Iași is known for the city of the seven hills. So, you know, biking in Iași will really put a strain on your body, right? But if a city like Iași can actually think of integrating a strategy like this, think of all of the cities in Romania that are mostly flat, that are perfectly designed to be biking cities, right? This is the inborn advantage of Amsterdam and many cities in the Netherlands, that everything is flat. You know, it's so much easier. But if Iași can do it, there, I'm pretty sure that's something that can be done everywhere.
Clever. Yeah, I agree. Yeah. And then just elaborate a little bit more, because it's always what happens if you have a dialogue like this. Things pop up in my mind. So I remember that we were in phase one and we saw we had a look at these infrastructures, the big complexes for sloughs and dams, etc. Oh, there's a lot of concrete. We can put some windmills and some solar panels on it. Yay, we're done. No, there must be more. There must be more. So we sat down and then we did find more. So of course you put solar panels or wind panels on it, but it doesn't have that sustainable big effect what you were looking for of the challenge we have in the Netherlands. And then we found then this heat, and then we realized that there are fish-friendly turbines you can put in there too. So, there's a new source of green energy. And then we realized that by rebuilding these dams and these sluices, you use a lot of concrete. It has to be very heavy to resist that fast-flowing power of rivers. But why don't we put the storage of the heat then in that big complex that saves concrete, which is better for nature? And then we thought, oh, wait a minute. So it can be that there is some heat and more of electricity needed on one side, just two objects further down the river. And these boats, these canal transport boats, they can transport that energy, electricity, and heat. They have to dock anyways for a certain kind of minutes. That's a business model. And then we thought, all right, so you have these little tourist boats, these private boats that are sailing and motorcycling. They need energy. So you can make these green energy kind of harbors for those people also to be on green energy. So all of a sudden you see that there is an energy hub of the future coming up. And if you then think wisely, and we would have stuck with that happy moment of, oh, wind panels or solar panels, yeah, of course, we should have missed the gold. That's about talking smart. Yeah,
exactly. Well, I must say this is a great, I'm really happy that this was our final conversation in this series, because I believe it really connects all of the dots that we've opened through these past weeks. And I will bring our His Excellency Mr. Rulo van Hees back in the stream. Because I wanted to once again thank you for participating in this project and creating this opportunity. For me personally, I saw an incredible value just seeing how all these ideas connect and seeing the possibilities. I remember, I think that one of the podcasts that almost, struck me a great deal was the discussion with Victor on the green spaces. And I remember when they were discussing about one of the spaces there, and I almost thought to myself, oh my God, well, this would be amazing in most of the cities around here. And so I'm hoping that everyone else that has joined in up until this point and who will see with the recordings will appreciate the effort and the context that has been created, because I honestly believe cities in Romania can become sustainable. They are waiting to be redesigned for decades now. And hopefully by this initiative, we'd make it possible. And I would love to give a few final words, to the opportunity also for our His Excellency, the Ambassador, as well as for Manon, for the people that have tuned in, for the people that are dreaming about building sustainable cities here in Romania, what would be your final message to them? First, His Excellency, and then I will lead the floor for Manon.
Thank you, Alex. It's been, as an embassy, our pleasure to initiate this. And coming up to the coming back to the question that Manon just raised, we're definitely very happy to liaise when it comes to Romanian demands in this field, in the many fields that passed in this series, and Dutch expertise. We're happy to liaise there. But I would like to add, I don't want to pour any cold water on this discussion at the very end. I've seen the ideal model. I've listened to the ideal model that Manon suggested. But Romania, certainly in the past, has suffered from a couple of fundamental issues. One I would mention is lack of funding is a big issue here. Now Romania is awaiting 80 billion euros in MFF and recovery funding. So maybe that issue is not on the table as much as it has been so far. The other thing is that Romania has had 12 different governments in 10 years' time. So when one talks about continuity, that has also posed an issue, but maybe with the upcoming political changes, we'll see improvement here too. I would say project management capacity in Romania is something that is subject to improve. And the Prime Minister on multiple occasions, Ludovic Orban, has said to the Romanian people and also to Brussels, in order to be able to spend wisely the 80 billion that I just mentioned, that the government is working on its project management capacity. And finally, so far, not looking at the future, some of the issues that Romania has. We spoke recently as EU ambassadors with the new mayor of Bucharest. And he said, please don't call me in the next 3 months, because I will be working day and night on solving, with the winter upcoming, the heating system, the heating issue of the capital of Romania. So, yes, Manon, I love the model that you described, and it makes all perfectly sense. But let's say if an administrator is faced in a couple of days, this morning I scraped the ice of the front screen of my car in Bucharest with a city of 2.5 million, where quite a large proportion of the population doesn't currently have central heating, then let's say the ideal model, which may be time-consuming because it's, inclusive, sometimes administrators in such difficult situations run to solutions, and it's almost inevitable that they go for a quick fix, something that you probably frown upon, but sometimes reality dictates that. So, in one sentence, I see a bright future for Romania with the upcoming funding, with the attempts the government is making. But where Romania currently sits in terms of its fundamental problems is something that is not easy to solve.
That is true. That is, it is, it is the challenge of the century for us. Definitely, definitely. Manon, your final words?
Yeah, I was expecting this. and that's we had the same. It's of course the challenges are different. We have the same, and it's about having a few bold pride people. Pride mm-hmm. people, which I certainly have seen in Romania the few times I've been there, to not be discouraged. Take a civil society challenge that is of importance. That of course these two paths can be there on the same time, because quick fixes need to be done. But if you have at a certain moment, there is a moment that you have to redesign the system, that you have to sit down and you have to spend money. And I said to our director, ministers, I said, hey, you're going to spend millions of euros. I'm not going to answer the chamber questions from our government that if you're spending millions of euros and you haven't spent a half a year just asking a few people, which you even don't have to pay for, if there's a better perspective that we can adapt in the same pathway that we have to do anyways. So there's always something to find. And they immediately understood. And that was the moment that we changed from one government to the other. We had new priorities, new strategy. Climate was in there. And this was after this little debate of about 5 minutes. It took me 5 minutes. And this was the answer of the Ministry of Transport to the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate. This is what we're going to investigate. We don't know what the answer is, but we have to take the moment and we have to take this into account.
Mm-hmm.
That's what being bold and proud and just finding the right moment and simply try to find that open window that's somewhere. There's always a little window somewhere. So that came indeed straight up my heart. It came a bit fierce, but it touches me because I see the knowledgeable, proud people who are really anxious to make something beautiful of Romania. You have a nice, there are nice windows of opportunities in there besides all the projects that you have. There is money, and I see the climate changing, the political climate changing in Romania. So there are, I get goosebumps, honestly, there are little windows of opportunities to find, and it doesn't have to be in the heart of all your problems. Take one that's prioritized enough. There is money, and start learning a little bit on the side, but it can be then as a side part just adapted in the main part. It's there to find, I'm sure.
Indeed. I very much appreciate the wording of, you know, being bold and proud about solving these problems. And I remember when Gratian and the whole team started the project a few years ago, it was very much that idea that, you know, we don't know where this is going to go. We didn't have a clear idea of where and what opportunities and could come up, but we knew that there was a great opportunity of bringing and coalescing all of these ideas, desires for innovation. And it is, I for one, even myself being part of the team, I'm incredibly surprised of how far we've come. And hopefully in the next few years, we can look back again and say, wow, we had no idea we would get here, but luckily we've managed to make a difference. Thank you again for everyone tuning in. It was a pleasure. And please follow the official page of the Embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands in Romania. Follow Urbanize Hub Romania and keep in touch for future events. We are working harder on a lot of great projects. And yes, 2020 is soon going to end, but 2021 awaits. And there's a great deal of innovation that we can do. And it's up to us to make that happen. Thank you all once again. Have a beautiful day. And let's be daring about the future of our cities.
Thank you, Alex and Manon, and thank you everybody else listening in.
Bye.